There are some exceptional cases of good growth, collective work, systematic work, etc. The ISRO, the Indian Army, the Election Commission, many top of the line hospitals, institutions like the old IITs, I don't know about the new IITs, the two recent, even places like Punjab University, the organization in which I work, they are part of this kind of breaking away from the herd, breaking away from close to everything that I've been saying till now is that the generalization about Indian society. These are institutions which have broken away from that. And what is the common theme among these organizations? Number one, absolutely number one, there's a tremendous amount of pride in the work that they do. The Indian Army's example is one of the most drastic examples. The Indian Army, everyone around the world notices, has the highest casualty rate among officers, the highest fatality rate amongst officers. So why is there a high fatality rate? And the answer is that the Indian officer is leading from the front. Samne there's a crevice which has to be crossed and the colonel says, okay, I'm going to cross it. Sir, you are 40 years old, how can you jump over this crevice like this with a 10 kilo load on you? He says, if I can ask you to jump it, I can jump it also, and he jumps. There's a terrorist over there and the brigadier picks up his gun and goes out to shoot the terrorist. Gets injured in the process. Happens in the military all the time. But there are just as many occasions when he succeeds. He does not tell the soldier, ki tu pehle ja, test kar. Tereko goli lag gayi to hume pata chal jayega ki kahan se goli aayi thi. He doesn't say that. He says, tu yahan ruk, main jata hun. Aur iska one of the offsides of this, one of the consequences of this is this. The Indian Army soldiers don't rebel. In the 60 years or more of the existence of the modern Indian Army, there's been only one small rebellion. And that was the rebellion at Sukma. Indian soldiers die for their officers. They have got tremendous respect for their officers. And the only reason for that is that the officer leads from the front. The officer does everything. The latrine ditch has to be dug. The officer says, "Mushkil mitti hai, main todta hun pehle." No problem. The soldier says, "Yadi sahab kar sakta, toh main bhi karta hun." Strongly merit-based. All these organizations, tremendous focus on merit. But not merit in that peculiar sense of wo jo main aapko example de raha tha 200 se leke 204 wala. That is stupid merit. Merit in the sense of the object of the organization is to perform this task. This task requires the following skills. This person has the following skills and therefore he'll be asked to do this. I've been closely associated with many of these organizations. I've been in touch with people from up close. In ISRO we went and there was this great rocket being made. And there was this old gentleman, great scientist. But there was a new technology which two boys were making. They'd come from a local polytechnic and they were designing it and they were working on it and it was going to be used in the next rocket launch that was going to happen. And the old gentleman says, Nana, he'll explain it to you. I don't know much about this area. And the young boy, like he's in his mid-20s, he gets up and comes in the middle and he explains to you, you know, sir, this is how this happens. You know, this is how this happens. And the old gentleman is very happy and pleased. Ki mere ladke dekho kitna jante hain, kitna sachche se samjha sakte hain. They take pride in it, which is in contrast to many other places where if you are going to get accolades, the big man is going to come forward and say, give me the accolades. Not over here. Here, accolades are shared according to how much work anyone has done on the basis of the clearly defined objectives of the organization. And everywhere in all these organizations, there's a serious effort at creating protocols. Protocols which need to be followed irrespective of what your private opinion about that protocol is. And these protocols are not created in a manner in which the sahab or the expert says that this has to be done. They're created in a self-reflexive manner. Everyone is participating in the creation of those protocols. So when everyone is participating in the creation of those protocols, everyone is also party to it. Everyone voluntarily does it. There's a sense of ownership. And just in case you think that people associated with the military are like this, I've given you two examples of the DRDO and the Ordnance Factory System. Bahut hi kaddu organizations hain. Great skills, great abilities, great facilities, not producing anything or almost not producing anything. And very fortunately for me today, I'd been thinking about this presentation of yours for the last 3-4 days. And today the newspaper says, the Director General DRDO says that giving fraud excuses for not doing work is not going to help us anymore. This is the head of the organization. He's gone on record in this interview saying that my organization is used to giving fraud excuses to everyone around them as to why they have not performed well. He says the time has come for us to perform. Why he says that, I don't know, but that is there. But the simple thing, I'll just summarize it, everything, and shut up after this. Entrepreneurial spirit is there in Indians in great quantities. However, having an entrepreneurial skill is not good enough. It's not sufficient. It's a necessary condition. You cannot do your projects and make in India adequately. You cannot take this country forward adequately if you do not have those entrepreneurial skills. You need them. But that is not sufficient. You also need other skills. One that you should know is that gender, caste, religion, they do not play a role in keeping the society down. They create a negative image in your mind. They set up obstructions. That's what I've been talking about till now. But they do not hold you back. They are not insurmountable. Actually, they, in many situations, they are not even a problem. Don't get it caught with this discussion of Rohit Vemula and Kanhaiya, etc., etc. Those things really don't exist. Those guys don't know what they're talking about. The important thing is to have the ability to focus on work. How to develop this, what to do about it. We know that as individuals, it's been possible for us to do it. Hundreds and thousands of Indians have been able to do it at the individual level. Question is how to do it in a collective manner so that everyone's energies are coordinated. Ability to be physically capable of work systematically is very important. One of the first persons who said that you should be physically strong was Vivekananda. But apart from Vivekananda, there was also Mao Zedong, the person who led China into a revolution. When the revolutionaries came, Mao was not a revolutionary. Mao was a librarian. Mao was a Communist Party member. He was a librarian, and he was the third in the hierarchy. He was the third rate leader. He was not even a leader. He was just a normal fellow sitting there with his chashma in the library, issuing books and reading books. Revolution is happening. Action is taking place. The first rung leadership is wiped out by the communists. Soviet communists, the nationalists of China, with the help of the Soviet communists, they wipe out the first rung leadership. Stalin is not happy with that either. He suggests that wipe out the second rung also. The second rung is wiped out. In a week's time, the Chinese Communist Party loses all its leaders. There's a vacuum, and this librarian gets up and he says, I will do the leadership now. And this leadership basically means running away from this place where everyone is getting killed. And in the process of running away, he discovers that everyone who was physically unfit simply lost out. They died, they were captured, they were killed. What were you doing? You were walking 60 kilometers a day, you were climbing mountains, you were eating dirty food. So what was lacking? He analyzes this and he comes up with a theory of revolution. He says, before bringing about a revolution, you have to be physically fit. He comes with a phrase, physical culture. You have to be good at physical culture. Muscle tagde hone chahiye aapke. Dimag tagda hona chahiye, ideas tagde hone chahiye, par muscle bhi tagda hona chahiye. The second fellow who talks about physical fitness is Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi in South Africa says that you have to be physically fit, and he adds one more thing, something which Mao did not figure out. Gandhi says you have to be spiritually strong also. And he gives a lot of formula on how you can be spiritually strong. My point at the moment is simply this, that there should be physical capability to do the work. If you don't have the physical capability, chemicals and such like are not going to be of help. Alcohol, cigarettes, chai, coffee, they don't work. They don't make you more efficient. They waste your time. Then there's this thing, you have the ability to be passionate about the work. Passion for your work comes from two sources. One is that you intrinsically from within you, you like to work. The second is you become passionate about anything that comes before you. In normal life, you'll discover that the occasions when you can do things which you like happen very few. If you're an extremely lucky person, maybe once or twice in your entire life, you'll get a chance to do actually what you wanted to do. But occasions when you'll get work just like that will be hundreds and thousands. If you can develop an ability to be passionate about anything and everything that you're doing, that would be an absolutely marvelous thing. How to do that? What happens into it? I don't know. But what I can suggest is that there are some societies which have created a system which which facilitates all these things. One of the reasons why Indians do so well in Europe and America is because the Europeans and Americans have cracked this particular puzzle. They've created a system which enables people to work. In India, we don't have that system yet. Will it be possible for us to have a system in the next generation? I don't know. But I do know that as an individual, you can create those systems around you. You don't need to bother about your government, your head of the department, your boss, your family. You can create that small environment around you. जैसे कुत्ते का नहीं बोलते, कुत्ता जब बैठता है तो अपनी जमीन साफ करके उसमें गोल गोल घूम के बैठता है. वो वहां से सीखना चाहिए हमें. जहां जितना थोड़े में हमारा काम है, जितने थोड़े में हमें कुछ करना है, उसको हम साफ कर लें, उतने में हम काम करना शुरू कर दें, दैट विल बी मोर देन सफिशिएंट फॉर एवरीवन एल्स.
डजंट दिस एक्चुअली प्रेजेंट अ पैराडॉक्स, बिकॉज़ part of the reason that Indians are able to do so well once they go to the West is because they've grown up in a place without such a system and have learned to survive in
adverse circumstances,
social conditions which are even more adverse. And consequently, in Western countries which now have a system, they have all these immigrants like Indians who are triumphing there because they've grown up in a condition without a system. So isn't this system kind of paradoxical?
Maybe it's paradoxical. The question is, Indians who have learned how to survive in an adverse social system, adverse cultural system, when they go into those enabling systems, their efficiencies go up substantially and they're able to thrive over there. So isn't there a paradox in this saying ki they should create a system and do that? I don't know whether there's a paradox or not. All that I can say is ki I don't see a way out, because unless you create that ecosystem around you which enables everyone to work, or which, if everyone to work is what the society and the government will have to do. The society isn't doing it, the government isn't doing it. But does that mean that we won't do it for ourselves? My submission at that point is, we could do it for ourselves. Many of us who work in universities, universities are, remember, not very helpful places. They are very obnoxious places to work in. You have your colleagues who try to trip you down, you have your superiors who try to trip you, you have your students who will try to trip you, all sorts of tripping happens. And everyone is fighting for stakes which are close to non-existent. यानी हजारों करोड़ों के लिए लड़ रहे हो तब तो समझ में आती है बात, केवल इज्जत के लिए लड़ रहे हो तो फिर तो नहीं समझ में आती ना बात. इवन ओवर देयर वी हैव डिस्कवर्ड दैट पीपल हु हैव बीन एबल टू क्रिएट स्मॉल इकोसिस्टम्स अराउंड देमसेल्व्स, इनेबलिंग इकोसिस्टम्स, दे हैव डन वेल. दोज हु हैव नॉट बीन एबल टू डू इट हैव नॉट डन वेल. द इंटायर आईटी इंडस्ट्री केम अप विद दीज 2, 3, 4 बिजनेस हाउसेज. रिमेंबर, ऑल दीज बिजनेस हाउसेज एक्टिवली रिफ्यूज टू पार्टिसिपेट इन द स्टैंडर्ड इंडियन सिस्टम. The standard Indian system was giving ghus, sucking up to the government. They refused to participate in that and they did rather well for themselves. Something of that would have to be done. But that is not the only area or the only set of people who do it all the time. Let me give you the example of people who have lived in completely adverse situations, absolutely adverse situations. Meeta was asking me ki ye slide tum kyon dikhana chahte ho, sare politicians to aisa karte hain. I would submit to you, madam, ki no, this is not what sare politicians do. This is not an example of sare politicians. This is the example from the north of Mehbooba, south Jayalalitha, east Mamata, west Anandiben. All of them have come from directions. They are women, so they are supposed to be low in social hierarchy of India. They are all lower caste people, so they are supposed to be low in the social hierarchy of India. None of them was rich to begin with, so they are low on everything. All of them have grown on their own, all of them are part of public life, all of them struggled, and all of them are tremendously successful. You could not be more successful than Jayalalitha, Mamata, Mehbooba, or Anandiben. Indians love people who are married, they seem respectable. Indians like people who are nice and kind, and the Indian selected a fellow who is neither nice, who is neither kind, who doesn't even have a wife. I mean, uske upar behas chal rahi hai, does he have a wife or does he have not have a wife? At the moment, he does not. Even in the face of the greatest of adversity, it has been possible for this bunch of people to succeed and reach the apex of what they were doing. We've seen the example of the IT guys who have done that. We've seen the example of the doctors who do it. We've seen the example of small-time businessmen who have done it. When we were talking about the early 20th century and all those Rabindranath Tagore advertisements, those are businessmen who are facing the most adverse circumstances and still succeeding. It's possible for Indians to create those small ecosystems for themselves and work very successfully. Why not we do that? Indians are the kind of people. I should give you one image. This is an alternate image, not the kind that I wanted to show you. Ye dekho. This is from a cave. 700 AD mein there are some boys who are making graffiti. It takes you quite a long time to make graffiti on the cave floor like this, and yet they have done it. The same kind of graffiti that boys and girls make in India in architectural monuments today. Continuity is hamari bahut tagdi hai. The one image, however, that I want you to see is this one. This is Mahashay Gulati. Recognize the face? Mahashay Di Hatti, MDH Garam Masala, MDH sabke har cheez ka masala. Twice displaced, and the leader of Masala Day, and feeling rather pleased with himself, instructing and informing all the young people ki unko apni zindagi kaise bitana chahiye. Look at this man. This is a sad looking man, but this is a young man. This was not the image that I wanted, but this was the one that I had, that other image gone. This is a young man who's looking bemused at the person who's taking the photograph. And the person who's taken this photograph, this is a Bombay image. The person who's taken this photograph says, when I asked him, why are you looking like this? He says, I just felt very amused that you want to take my picture cleaning up your sewer of the build, your society. And I mean, how much more funny can this be? This is a young man who can find some funniness even in the response of the normal society to the job that he is doing. Given an opportunity, he would rather leave this job. Not given an opportunity, he doesn't rue it too much. He doesn't complain about it too much. All that he does is, he does his wonderment and stuff.
Is that a metaphor for our condition?
It is. We will have to get out of being in the sewer, and we will have to say that it's possible for us to do something more. It's possible for us to change that sewer. And just in case you think that it's only Indians who do this and this is because of caste, no, this is not how Indians do it. This is how everyone does it. People who do dirty work, work which puts them so dirty. The English, for example, had a body of people called the night men who would be doing precisely this job in the 19th and the early 20th century. Then the English came up with this notion that you should have proper sewers which can be properly managed and maintained. So why don't the engineers of India come up with proper sewers which can be properly managed and maintained? Oh, you know Indians throw garbage all over. Of course Indians throw garbage all over. So don't you know that Indians throw garbage all over? Why don't you sit down and use your brains and try to figure out how can you either prevent the Indians from throwing the garbage, or if the garbage has come in, then how to get it out? Why do you want a human being to jump into it? You need technological solutions. The moment that technological solution came in, the sewer man, the night man vanished. Not only did the nightmen vanish, the garbage collection system in the West changed. There was a time when the garbage collector man would come after 9 in the night, collect your garbage and take it away and dump it outside the town. Today, the garbage collector man comes early in the morning and collects your garbage. After having thrown away the garbage, he sits with you and eats a burger with you. There's no distinction between you and the garbage collector. Now, that has happened because of technology. We need technologies of that variety. If only someone could sit down and think, the needs of this kind of people are also very, very important and significant for us. The judge is lacking and the lawyer is lacking. So when the Chief Justice of India cried, Narendra Modi asked the Vidhi organization, Vidhi karke ek NGO hai, which is run by retired judges and young lawyers. And Amin is in working for Vidhi. He's a senior consultant with Vidhi today, one of my friend's son. So usne report bheji hai, jo akhbaron mein bhi chhapi hai, that says most of the delay in cases happens because Indian judges give unending stays. An average case in India takes 13 years, of which 6 years are merely the judge giving stays. So the judges will have to stop giving stays. The judges will have to say that if the case has to be heard on such and such day, the case will be heard on such and such day. The protocol says, the law says that no adjournment will be given, no stay will be given, and yet the judges routinely do this. So someone will have to tell the judges, stop doing it, behave properly. Today the judges and the lawyers are behaving in some of the most obnoxious ways. In case you guys are on Facebook, visit my Facebook page. I've got a very special grouse against judges. I write against judges and lawyers all the time. I also write a lot of history. I've got a page called India History where I share all such information also. But the judges need to be improved by the judges themselves, not by you and me. Because if we say that the executive should improve the judges, the judicial system, then a problem is coming up. Judges are the body of people to whom we go when we have discovered that all our other mediation mechanisms have failed. You say one thing, I say one thing, we disagree. We need a third party, an independent third party, certifiedly independent, who is going to mediate between us. And once that third party is mediated, we will say, we will stop this jagda. Hence, we cannot interfere with the judges. Not because we are scared of the judges. We should criticize them, condemn them, everything. But we should enable the independence of the judiciary and not allow the government to interfere. The government is ready with interference. We should not allow that to happen as citizens.
So, you think India and China are historically different? If no, then why is it that what has enabled the Chinese to go so far as compared to India?
A, India and China are not different. Actually, when you go into the details of Chinese history, the narrative is almost the same that we had earlier about what are the strong points of India, they are also the strong points of China. What are the weaknesses of India, including the caste system? The Chinese also have a similar caste system, similarly entrenched, similarly justified, and similarly not followed. That example of the four women that I gave you, the first day I gave you those images of people, low caste, low family, low economic class people who did so well in life. China has stories of that variety also. Where is China differing from India? China differs from India in something called philosophy. Indians have Hindu philosophy, which allows you to be completely independent in thought and everything, as much independent as you want. You can decide what you want to do, and that is perfectly all right. The Chinese have Confucianism, in which one interpretation of Confucianism says that you need to obey your elders. That is serious business. In India, there's a small element of obeying your elders. Pind jante ho kya hota? Pind daan karna? Hai na? Pind daan karna, pitron ki samman karna, India ki culture mein bhi hai. Have you heard these phrases, pind daan karna, pitron ka samman karna, any of you? Jisne nahi suna hai, wo haath khada karo, please. Kaafi log hai na? In India, these phrases exist only as phrases, and today only in areas where there is some conservative family or conservative person within the family. Otherwise, Indians have simply forgotten about them. And this is not forgetting which has happened today. This is forgetting which has happened thousands of years ago. We don't listen much to our elders. We don't respect our elders and ancestors too much. We use our ancestors once in a while. The Chinese don't. Now, one of the consequences of that is that ancestors वगैरह तो theory की चीज़ होगी, culture की चीज़ होगी. One of the practical and pragmatic consequences of this is that when your boss tells you to do something, in China you do it, in India you wonder whether you should do it or not. Makes all the difference to collective work and collective efforts. That is part of that ISRO and army story. The election commission story. Election commission said, officers will be sent to the field as observers and they will look at everything, and these are the protocols that they have to follow. Everything is given to them. So what did the officers do? IAS, IPS officers. They went into the field aur khub aas-paas unhone darshan kiye jagahon ke, touring ki, apni puri family ko leke gaye. The election commission in the next election had to issue special orders. No, no, you can't take your family with you. You're going to be there for 1 month, but you can't take your family with you to the election duty. So the next time they went, दारू की बोतल लाओ जी, चिकन लाओ जी, आराम से घुमाओ जी, म्यूजियम भी दिखाओ जी, जंगल भी घुमाओ जी. The election commission once again stepped in and said, no, no, you can't do this also. You are on official duty. You will behave as if you are sitting in your office. This is not your home. This is not your aram gaha. This is not your pleasure house. In the meanwhile, there was a transformation in the IAS. People who were coming from St. Stephen's and great colleges and universities stopped coming. Instead, the lower colleges, second tier colleges started throwing up students who were very bright and making it. Aisa nahi tha ki Stephen's boys are not applying. They are still applying. They just can't make it into the exam anymore because the boys from the smaller towns are doing much better. Those boys come, and now the election commission does not address the bada sahabs, the observers. Now the election commission addresses the collector sahab, the fellow on the ground. and the election commission says no facility to the Bada Sahib other than a room to stay, a secretariat to work with, a phone and a gadi, nothing more. Some of the Bada Sahibs, the horror stories that I have heard personally, the Bada Sahib went and took the gadi to Darshan Karo, some temple 500 kilometers away. He came back and the collector Sahib gave him a bill of 1000 kilometers. Sir, 1000 kilometers multiplied by Sarkari rate 20 rupees, this you will have to pay. The observer Sahib was most upset. How can this happen? The collector said, the election commission is told to do it. They were following the protocol that was given to them. Earlier, they were not following the protocol. Following protocols is extremely important if you want to do work on a large scale. Not every protocol is correct. Protocols need changing. But you should be changing protocols only when you can discuss it amongst yourself, create a collective opinion and then change it. The taking of attendance is part of protocol. Did you people do your attendance in school? No. Did you people do all your lab work as dictated by the CBSE? No. I can certify that to you. Are you doing your attendance properly in college? Absolutely not. Is your teacher following your attendance protocols properly? No. Is the teacher being told by the HOD, follow? No. Is the HOD being told by the director, the principal or the vice chancellor, do your work properly, sir? What kind of a professor are you? No. Collectively, the answer at every layer is no. How can you expect a large system to function in a healthy manner? In China, in Japan, you do, in Korea, even in Vietnam and Thailand and Burma, you don't need to do. In Sri Lanka, you don't need to do it. In Sri Lanka, if everyone agrees that this work should be done, it is done. In Burma, if they agree, it is done. In Thailand, it gets done. In Korea, Japan and China, to khair bahut hi jyada hota hai. So why don't Indians do it? My submission is, remember, it's a collective pattern. Once it is a collective pattern, it becomes a social fact. And my submission is that this social fact is a consequence of that great freedom that we have had in the past and the culture of Hinduism. You don't have to be a Hindu. You can be a Christian, Jew, Parsi, Muslim, Sunni, Bora, Memon, really doesn't matter. So long as you are in India, this is how you behave. Only India? No. They do it like this in Bangladesh also. They do it precisely like this in Pakistan also. We got a visa to Pakistan to visit Lahore. Hamare ek saathi ne kaha ki mera pind tha, purana gaon tha, main gaon dekhna chahta hoon 300 kilometer dur. Hamare host ne kaha chalo dikha ke laate. Usne kaha nahi yaar, I got a visa only for Lahore. It says only for Lahore, not outside. He says, kya baat karte ho, gaadi mein baitho. 300 kilometer gaye, 300 kilometer wapas aa gaye. Savere gaye, shaam ko wapas aaye, dinner wapas aake Lahore mein kiya. Breaking each and every rule. चोरी से किया था? नहीं, चोरी से नहीं किया था, सरकारी गेस्ट थे हम लोग, साथ में थानेदार भी था, पुलिस वाले भी थे, फॉरेन ऑफिस के लोग भी थे, सब कुछ चल रहा था, सारे रूल्स तोड़ते हुए किया गया. इंडिया, पाकिस्तान, बांग्लादेश, नेपाल, वी आर एक ही थैली के चट्टे बट्टे, नॉट फॉलोइंग एनी रूल्स, ऑर्डर्स और प्रोटोकॉल. हाउ टू लर्न दैट? आई डोंट नो. हाउ टू ट्रांसफॉर्म द सोसाइटी इनटू a society which does these things without becoming an obedient society. The example is China. China is not an obedient society and yet it is able to do all that. Perhaps someone will have to get down and make a comparative study.
But don't you think another question that needs to be asked is, do we need to learn that? Because it's a bit of a trade-off, right?
Like, absolutely.
When we become organized, we also lay the foundations for oppression, which is what yeah. is happening
in China. It's a trade-off between freedom and being obedient. And how do we do it and where do we do it? At the moment, there are no standard answers to it. Your question is absolutely valid and someone will have to come up and give us a correct answer to this particular question. How to go about doing these things? Why to do these things in a particular manner and not the other manner? Since we have discovered that individuals are not able to come up with answers, perhaps as we talk like this, not in just in this forum, but in many other forums also, between ourselves. Because remember, as soon as you grow up a little bit, you are going to be faced with the same existential problems. You are running a factory and the worker says, I'm not going to obey you. So you need to figure out how to make this fellow obey you. Small time solutions have been possible till now. But we need large scale solutions. Small time solutions have produced small time benefits. We need large scale solutions which will produce civilizational benefits for us. How to do it? I'm at a loss.
How do you explain the Indian Army and ISRO and stuff like that?
Ah, the two, three things in the Indian Army ISRO system that I would like to point out that I highlighted over there. Pride in the work at hand. When we talked about the Indian workers never rebelling before the 19th century, it was not just about having enough food to eat and a good place to live in and everyone talking to them nicely. It was also that they had a tremendous amount of pride in the work. If you ever go to Agra, to the Taj Mahal, spend a lot of time in Taj Mahal, but retain at least 30 minutes of yours for that small village which is next to the Taj, just across the road. This is the village of the same artisans who had constructed the Taj. Unke jo baki bache log the, wo wahi bas gaye. Unse jaake aap baat karke dekho. And think about the amount of positivity that they feel about the work that they are doing. That positivity, the pride in the work that is being done. Their ancestors worked on Sangmarmar and stone. They continue to do it. If you ever go to Mamallapuram, go to the village and over there visit some of the workshops. Many of the guys are still using the same techniques that their ancestors did 1,000 years ago. And the way they talk about their business, the craft that they are practicing, tells you that they feel very nice and happy about it. That is important, feeling pride in the work that you have to do. Visit Paithan. There's a small village a little away from here, about 4-6 hours away from here. Visit Paithan. Paithan is the traditional sari weaving village. There's a typical family lives in a house which is about this big. And most of the house is just a gadha, the size of a sari. 9 gaj ka gadha hai. Aur us gadde mein unhone apna loom laga rakha hai. The whole family surrounds the place, lives over there, cooks over there, lives in this place. And they're so happy about doing what they're doing. They feel pleasure because they think that they've got a unique skill which only they have and no one else has. Pride in the work that they're doing is very, very important. Today we have lost that pride. Feeling involved in the work. Second thing, the Indian does not feel involved in the work. I had suggested earlier that develop the ability to develop a passion for the work that you're doing. Don't bother about the Angrej tells us you should do what you have a passion for. A passion, yadi guitar chalana hai, to you should do certainly guitar chalana. Ye passion gaane gaane ka, wo bhi karna chahiye. Passion engineering karne ka, to zarur karna chahiye. But you will discover ki passion to zindagi mein choti si cheez ke liye hota hai. The thousands of other things to be done. The ability that you need to develop is passion for doing most of those thousands of things with great energy, great effort and great interest. And that comes from a mindset thing. You should not, permit me to say so, you should not follow the Western notions of how good work is done. You should follow the Indian notion of how good work is done. Those stone crafters that I'm telling you about, those potters that I showed you the images of, they all feel happy doing it. The only person who does not feel happy doing the job, I mean, who doesn't say ki agle janam mein bhi main yahi kaam karunga, main apne bete ko bhi yahi kaam karwaunga, is that person who is inside the sewer. He says, I'm inside the sewer. The Bombay sewer man is inside the sewer because the BMC gives him a quarter for free. Yadi aapko South Bombay mein ek kholi free mein milti hai rehne ke liye, so you are the first person to get married. You get married to the girl who is bringing the largest amount of dahej. You have got a property for the next 40 years from where you can leverage the rest of the family. The Indian Express had done a story on the sewer man of Bombay. And this is the structure they found across in that entire building. And every family has a son or a daughter now working in Saudi or in America or in the UK. Someone is in the construction industry. Someone is an engineer. Someone is a doctor. Someone is a scientist. These are not sons and daughters of sewer men anymore. And yet they all have been there because there was one brother in the family who was sacrificed to this job. That is a sacrifice. You cannot be passionate about being sacrificed. But for work, you can.
I want to comment on obeying the system or being independent. Like if you can do a fruitful on being a system, then you should not need to obey the system. You can do independent, but if you are not doing any good, fruitful or still you are not obeying the system, that is wrong.
Absolutely. You are completely correct in that. A, there is a dilemma. How much should you obey and how much should you be asking the system to be fruitful about you? B, there's a problem over there of obedience rebellion. And for these issues, till now, from the 19th century onwards, we have not had a standard good solution. There have been spiritual kind of solutions, but spiritual solutions don't work in real life. There have been philosophical suggestions. One can say one needs to establish a balance, etc., etc. That also doesn't work. So, at the moment, what one can suggest is every individual is going to be faced with a unique situation, a unique set of problems on how, to what extent to be obedient and to at what point to disobey. Everyone will have to come up with an answer, a solution, a response, which is going to be unique to their own location at that moment. And remember, when you are responding to disobeying the system, when you are trying to disobey the system is going to hit back at you and hit back harshly, try to blackball you. So you have to be very strategically placed so that you cannot allow the system to harm you. There's a friend of mine, Yogendra Yadav. Some of you might have seen him somewhere or read something from him. He's one of those guys who does election kind of stuff. So Yogendra Yadav ka ek bahut acha, wo bahut acha aadmi hai. मैं भी बहुत अच्छा आदमी हूँ, उसके साथ रहता था, बहुत अच्छा आदमी हूँ. उसका भी आइडिया होता था और उसको मैं पूरी तरह से कंकर करता था, पूरी तरह से एग्री करता था. इफ यू आर अ नाइस मैन, इफ यू आर नॉट अ करप्ट मैन, इफ यू डू करेक्ट थिंग्स, देन ए यू कैन नॉट बी स्टूपिड. यू कैन नॉट बी स्टूपिड एंड नाइस. यू हैव टू बी वेरी ब्राइट एंड बी वेरी नाइस. You should know what dirt the society or organization, the people around you can dish on you. Second, first, be nice. Second, don't be stupid about it. Third, be extremely intelligent in overcoming the obstructions that are going to happen to you. Take the example of the Election Commission. The Election Commission, and the first time 91-92, it told the senior officers, please go into the field, see how elections are done. Senior officers made a mess of it. 96-97, the Election Commission said, go into the field. The officers went and once again made a mess of it. 2004, the commission said, did not address the senior officers, it addressed the junior officers. And bacche, nazar rakhna, sahab ke upar gadbad na kare. 542 जिले थे, उन जिलों में केवल 8 या 10 बच्चों ने एक्चुअली साहब को तवा लगाया, पर 8-10 बच्चों ने जो तवा लगाया उसका असर यह हुआ कि वो सारे 542 जिलों के साहब ठीक हो गए और उसके बाद वो सब ठीक रहे. द स्ट्रैटेजी हैज टू बी करेक्ट. व्हेन यू आर ट्राइंग टू बी करेक्ट एंड डूइंग करेक्ट थिंग्स, द स्ट्रैटेजी हैज टू बी करेक्ट सो दैट द अदर गाय कैन नॉट शॉर्ट सर्किट यू. रेबल होना, शहीद होना बकवास चीज है. शहीद तो कभी भी नहीं होना चाहिए किसी भी चीज के लिए. जिंदगी है तो जहान है, नौकरी है तो सब कुछ ठीक चलने वाला है. यू हैव टू मेंटेन कि शहादत से दूर रहना है, एंड येट यू हैव टू इंश्योर दैट यू विल बी एबल टू ट्विस्ट द सिस्टम एंड डू थिंग्स. कम टू पंजाब सम टाइम. इन पंजाब वी हैव दिस सेइंग अबाउट व्हाट द गुरुज टोल्ड यू. द गुरु सेड दैट बी नाइस एंड हम्बल, बिकॉज इफ यू आर स्टैंडिंग स्ट्रेट एंड फेसिंग द विंड, इट विल ब्लो यू ऑफ लाइक इट ब्लोज अवे द ट्री. Be nice and humble, but at the same time, be intelligent enough and wise enough to be able to train a sparrow to kill a hawk. The guru says, I know how to train a sparrow to go and kill a hawk. The hawk is the Mughal, the sparrow is the farmers, the peasants, and the small people in Punjab and Haryana region. That is what you need to do. Okay, the question is that you say that there should be passion for the work or whatever you're doing. At the same time, you're recommending that you would suggest that the majority of India should go into these Kaliyugi kind of trainings like engineering, medical, etc., etc. And majority of the people who get into these courses of study, they are not happy doing that, and they would rather do something else. My submission is that you that you expand it a little more and include the sciences also in it. Include the ITIs also in it, include any kind of technical training also into it, and that is the case everywhere. Uska jo response hai, that would be at 2-3 levels. At one level is that fellow who's gone into fine arts or the history of philosophy or history or sociology happy doing what he's doing. And I can assure you with 30 years of experience as a teacher in diverse environments that no, they are also not happy doing what they are doing. So that's okay. Happiness is jitna engineering or medical karne mein happiness ki kami hai, utni happiness ki kami udhar bhi hai. It is that which suggests to me that happiness is not a function of what you are studying or what you have been asked to train in. Maybe the search for happiness has to be at a different level doing something else. And therefore, this other statement, the other recommendation that we need to not be happy, but to be efficient, effective, passionate about whatever we are doing. Let's take the example of the army once again. This is something which I tell my friends in the IAS all the time. I've been associated with the police training academy, with the income tax training academy and the IAS training academy very closely. And every time I've told them to look at jahan IAS training academy, uske bagal mein army training academy hai. The army takes in people who are completely in the Indian context, completely down and out. The rich, aristocratic, socially well-off person is not getting into the army anymore. The person who thinks that there is no job available other than the military and I can run a mile in so many minutes, he's the one who's going into the army. And not everyone is practicing to do that. What the army does is the army says, we don't care who you were before. Once you're with us, we are going to delete your personality that existed earlier. We are going to reboot you into the army culture and we are going to feed the army into you. The army, the air force, you go to Pune, us sare ladke bhaag bhaag ke pahad chadh rahe hote the. A student of mine, she is all of 25 years old. She's joined the army. She came back and she told me, abhi April mahine ki baat hai. She came back and she told me, sir, it's an amazing experience. They don't even ask you to do anything. They don't ask you to think. They don't ask you to work. They don't ask you to do anything. They just give you this 20 kilo load, 40 pounds. And they say, run from this point to that point. After you've run from this point to that point, they say, run from that point to this point. After you've done this 3 times, your mind is a total blank. You don't think of anything else. And once your mind is a total blank, they feed in whatever ideology. Remember, she's a grown up woman now. She's just about to get married. And had she been a traditional kind of system, she would already be having a large number of children. And she says, they've emptied your mind and now they're filling it with all sorts of things that they wanted to fill. And she says, they're very successful in it. There are no failures in our training. Everyone does it. These are not people who are passionate. It was the organization which made them passionate. And once they start succeeding in it, in case you people have ever trained dogs, cats and parrots and mynas, you would know ki kaise usko train kiya jata hai. Ek to you have to set up communication links with him. Dusra, you have to start repeating whatever you need that particular thing to be trained in. Repeating in a particular manner which doesn't antagonize the person. But teesra, you have to be nice and compassionate about it. You can't take a whip up and start whipping your animal friend. You will have to be nice and compassionate about it so that that animal is able to do it voluntarily to you all the time. I can tell you I have done it with cats. Billi dawai nahi khati hai. मैंने बिल्ली से कहा अच्छा यहां बैठो मैं तुम्हारे सामने बैठा हूं ये दवाई तुमको खाना है खाना पड़ेगी आई सेट देयर फॉर 10 मिनट्स टेलिंग द बिल्ली खाओ दवाई खाओ दवाई खाओ दवाई इन द एंड यू कुड सी द फेस दैट शी वाज मेकिंग एट मी शी जस्ट जंप्ड अप एंड टुक द दवाई फ्रॉम माय पाम एंड एट इट एज अ म्याओ आई सेड ठीक है म्याओ शी डिडंट टेक इट आउट आई हैव अ लॉट ऑफ पेशेंस एज अ टीचर इवन व्हेन आई वाज अ चाइल्ड दिस हैपेंड व्हेन आई वाज इन स्कूल But this is what you have to do. When Aarti, this student of mine, told me this story from the OTS, this is precisely what the army was doing over there. This is what all good institutions would do. Prakash Tandon, please have a look at his book. Prakash Tandon says, I came to the IIM in 1971 and the immediate thing that I noticed was that the IIM boys have gone on a strike. Why have they gone on a strike? Because they've discovered that there is some social justice happening in Ahmedabad. Social injustice happening in Ahmedabad, and the boys and girls of IIM Ahmedabad have gone on a strike. The government has put in all this money, the industrialists have put in all this money, and the institution is not functioning. So he says, I had gone from a business background and I had gotten into this business as a person who was selling dalda, taking dalda from house to villages, asking people ki ghee khana band kar do, dalda khana shuru karo. I knew how people behave and why people behave the way they behave. So he said, I started looking around and I discovered that these students are supposed to work only 40 hours a week. And even in that 40 hour a week, which is the official hour, they're able to get away with working for 4 to 5 hours a week. He said, I had a detailed meeting with the faculty and I insisted that the workload should be increased to 70 hours a week. The moment the workload was increased to 70 hours a week, two things happened. One, students became passionate about the work. There was so much work to be done that everyone was focused on it. Second, their performance improved so much more. IIM Ahmedabad, which was merely producing lousy managers with one diploma certificate in their pocket, and the standard knowledge of those times was, don't hire from these IIMs, these are just fancy colleges which don't do anything much. If you really want to hire a person as a manager, hire him like Prakash Tandon has been hired. School se nikle hue chhokre ko pakdo, uske haath mein dalde ka dabba thama aur bolo ki ja re bech ke aa. If he succeeds in bechoing the dalde ka dabba, he becomes a good manager. If he doesn't succeed, kick him out. This was the principle of those times. Prakash Tandon says, by increasing the workload to 70 hours, we ensured that the boys that were coming out of this institution were the best in the country. Once you had the best in the country coming out, then it was the best in the country who were coming in. And a cycle set in, and that cycle continues till now. He says it in so many words, he documents it. Unfortunately, we have not discovered how working hard helps. If you have ever participated in a marathon, if you have ever walked 30 kilometers, if you have ever carried a person like this physically for 1 kilometer, you will understand what I am saying. The mind goes blank by the physicality of the effort. And then you can focus the mind on something. Oh, go for a long drive if you like to drive. Don't drive at 60 kilometers, drive at 120 kilometers. It's safer to drive at 120 because you are forced to focus on your driving. You don't see anything but that small patch of road about 30-40 yards in front of you. Nothing else is visible. Ye kehna ki ji, I went for such a long drive and I saw the scenery. Kya scenery dekhoge? Sara focus to driving pe hota hai. Do that. Try to focus your mind. Or do something which Professor Arya has been telling me for such a long time. Meditate. The Indians had discovered the value of meditation long ago. And close to everyone who has participated in meditation exercises well says that it brings about a transformation. And it's a positive transformation. It really doesn't matter what you meditate on, how you meditate. All that you've got to do is sit down and train your mind. It's mind training. Some people hire trainers. Some people just think about a guru or a bhagwan or a word or something like that and do it. The results are almost the same almost all the time. But you need to do it.
America about nation building, which goes something like, I must study law and war and politics so that my children can study science and medicine, and my children must study science and medicine so that their children can study the arts and literature. So I suspect India is at that second stage at this at present. So how much time and effort do you think it will take for us as a country to get to the third stage?
I think is a very second stage is what you should do. And after the second stage, the third stage should be happening along with the second stage. The question is that I should study law at the military, war, etc., so that I can create a situation where my children can study sciences and technology, and they should be studying sciences and technology so that their children can study the fine arts. My answer to that is, studying the fine arts is something that goes hand in hand with all these other studies. It is, these are not, studying the fine arts is not something which you do independent. I'll give you my own personal private example. I never studied history. My total contact with professional history, mother as a middle-aged matronly woman was to write a PhD. She said, ki, I want to write a PhD in history, and my father said, why don't you do that? Khali pili ghar mein baithne se kya hota hai? I was doing my final years of school and I had access to all the books that she used to bring, and I would read all of them in Hindi. There was no English around. Then I started reading all the history stuff that used to come in Parag, Chanda Mama, Saptahik, Hindustan, Dharmyog. And in the course of things, it so happened that I bumped into a man who said, I was not interested in studies. I mean, mathematics, I used to score well, but I'm not interested in mathematics. Aisa nahi ki mere dimag mein ideas aate of the kind that my colleagues have. I'm not interested in the sciences in the sense ki baith ke usko bada sara seekho, samjho, etc., etc. My chemistry professor was working on something to do with family planning in rats and he wanted me to work with him. I said, ye bhi koi topic hai, family planning in rats. Anyway, so I didn't do any of that. So this friend of the family, he said, JNU chale jao, aap kuch bhi padh sakte ho. So main kuch bhi padhne ke chakkar mein JNU aa gaya, maine wo test diya, history ka entrance exam diya and they chose me and they gave me very high marks in the merit list. I said, if I am a good historian, Dharmyog, Parag, Chanda Mama, padhne ke baad bhi, if I am a good historian, then maybe this is where the area where I should be. I didn't develop a passion for history. My total passion was I should get out of formal studies altogether. I finished my PhD because my supervisor was an American kind of fellow and he kept on insisting ki kaam samay pe hona chahiye. Jis samay tumne kaha ki chapter dena to chapter dena padega. Tumne kaha ki itna document padhoge, padhna padega. You have to learn three languages. Just bloody well sit down and learn your three languages. So I learned Marathi, I learned Gujarati, I learned Urdu. And I started reading those documents. Completely mechanical task. I finished my PhD in 3.5 years. Put that document on the side. I was on a very, very rich fellowship. In those days, fellowship amounts, the same fellowship amount, but in those days, they were very rich. The college lectures used to get much less than what we did, especially if you were in JNU. So then I spent the time roaming around the jungles, going into the desert, totally vela time with friends, not faltuka time, constructive kind of stuff. And then one day, an advertisement came for Punjab University. I did not even apply for it. My friend who was already teaching in Punjab University, he sent me a letter saying, Rajiv Lochan, please apply for this. I am leaving this job. I am going to Shimla because that is my hometown. You can take up my job. So I went there. They took me in. I mean, I was not unemployed ever. I submitted my thesis in April. In May, I got my job without any pull, without any pressure. And then I went to Chandigarh with 72 rupees, 72 rupees in my pocket, two trousers. All my saman in JNU with a clear objective, वापस आ जाना यहाँ से, ये पढ़ाने पुढ़ने का टीचरी बनने का नहीं बनने का मेरे को. And I have stayed there 30 years simply because when you went there and you met these extremely fresh faces in front of you, every time you could trade with new ideas, something new could happen, some new ideas were coming up, a passion developed. But this passion developed as was not a consequence of wanting to develop a passion, it was a consequence of just mechanically doing a large amount of work. And I used to read a lot. That was something that I did all the time. And I was reading Picasso. And Picasso says, there's this boy who comes to him and he says, I want to be a painter. So Picasso draws a circle and he says, acha isme circle ka center point out kar do. The boy points out a circle. Picasso takes a scale, draws standard lines and says, this is not the center. So the boy goes back, he trains himself a little more. This time he comes to Picasso and Picasso says, no, what you should do is, you should first draw freehand circle and then put the center in it. He's trained himself to do the center. He's not trained himself to do the circle. So he's failed once again. He goes back once again. He comes back a third time. This time also he's failed. He asks a question and he's the one who reports all this. So it's not Picasso who's reporting, it's this fellow who has been failed by Picasso, who hates Picasso and who's never becoming a big painter anywhere. He's the one who's reporting it to us. And he says, I failed once again. So I asked Picasso, why are you asking me these silly questions? You have to be creative. You have to be sensitive. You have to be expressive. Picasso said, what nonsense. If you want to draw a good painting, see, this is how I do my painting. And he took him into the studio. And in the studio, remember, this is a boy whom he has rejected many times and he's not even going to take him up as a student even now. And he shows him. The first painting is a normal standard painting. The second version is one in which he has distorted images a little bit. Third version is more distortion is set up. Fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh. The 15th version is the one which is actually going up on the final canvas. He says, this final canvas was always there. But before this, I was using my scrapbook to experiment with shapes and sizes and breaking up of images, etc., etc., etc. This is pre-First World War period. This boy, later on, the First World War breaks out. He joins the French army and immediately there's a problem in the First World War. Before that, people used to wear clothes which are bright and shiny. And thousands of soldiers are getting killed in the war. This man suggests, he tells his commanding officer, "Sir, I have an idea. You know, this happened with me with Picasso," and he narrates the whole thing. And he says, "And Picasso's final thing was, I should break shapes in such a manner that the human eye cannot see it anymore." So the commanding officer says, "How can you not see something which you can see with your eyes? I mean, there's a cow. You can see it with your eyes, so there's a cow." But he says, "No, no, Picasso ne kya kiya? He's broken the shapes." He says, "That's very funny. Even after you've broken the shape, you can still see it." He says, "No, give me a chance. It's possible to break shapes using lines in such a manner that the human eye cannot see it." And he produces the first formal, proper camouflage designs for any army in the world. Essentially, he's copying Picasso. Today that you see the camouflage uniforms, they are take off on. And in case you want to ever judge it, look at a soldier wearing camouflage from a distance. Unless you know who he is, chances are that you'll notice a large number of people around him, but you'll skip the soldier. Because the camouflage today is so highly developed that you don't need to do wo sniper wala nahi karne ki zarurat padti. All that you need to do is break the shape by drawing a line here, by drawing a line here, by drawing a line here. So much so, when the Motor Vehicles Act was being passed, the Motor Vehicles Act has a sentence over there which says you cannot change the color and the lines of your vehicle. Putting up stickers, making extra lines, extra decorations, all that is illegal because it breaks the outline and the object ceases to be visible. Thing is, passion, value, love for your task, Mr. Picasso was saying, comes as a consequence of hard work and labor for what you're doing. That seemed to match with much of what I used to think. So that narrative, I absolutely fell in love with Picasso and I studied more of Picasso and stuff like that. But I think that is what every one of us needs to do. Getting educated is something which requires, today society needs science and technology. It really doesn't matter who you are. You should know science and technology. You need mathematics today, so you should know mathematics. You need statistics today, you should know statistics. Do you also need to know history, society, culture, literature, etc., etc.? Yes, you do. But that is of a secondary nature. You have to be sensitive about it, but not necessary. It's not necessary knowledge. It's add-on knowledge. That's what I would say. Okay. Thank you very much. Very kind of you to be here. Namaskar.